There we go. So welcome, everybody, to another Neutral Zone Unmasked. We have a very exciting show tonight, a very special guest, and you know him from a lot of things, but I think you're going to find out some things that are very fascinating about him. And that is stuntman and actor Bobby Clark. Welcome, Bobby.
Thank you very much. Glad to be here.
Excellent. So we're going to be talking about quite a number of different things throughout the next couple of hours. If anybody has any questions and wants to put them on Facebook, they can do that. If you want to join us on Zoom, you certainly can, but we're going to save those questions for a little later on in the show. And as well, there's a link that Larry is putting up on the page, and it's going to be, if you'd like to get a personalized and autographed picture of Bobby, then you can order it right through the website. So, you know, everybody kind of stand by, but I'd really like to get started. And I'm going to ask Bobby, we talked a little bit before we got on the air, and I asked the first question. And the first question was, I was curious how a young man decides that he wants to become a stuntman. Because it doesn't seem like something that you would, you know, sort of like think up on your own. So, Bobby, I'm going to ask you if you wouldn't mind letting us know how you became a stuntman.
I can do that. I can do that. I became a stuntman and worked in the motion picture business industry, I should say. I started in late 1957. That's when I decided that's what I was going to do. Prior to that, that was my, I had a whole life before that. But I became a stuntman when I decided to think and figure that I wanted to be noticed. I guess I didn't have a bad feeling about me, but it seemed to me that it would be nicer to be somebody. Like, look at this guy climbing that tree up there, way up. He's up 100 feet, hanging there from a rope. And they're looking at you. That was something that brought my attention to it. And just in general, to be noticed. And I did a lot of things before I became a stuntman. I did a lot of extra work. And then I decided to become a stuntman and had to prepare for that and take the falls and everything. Of course, I always figured, being I'm a half cowboy anyway, I would say that anybody can fall off a horse. I mean, that's the easiest thing in the world you can do. Staying on seems to be the hard part. But I did a lot of that, and I did a lot of fights and falls and doubled actors and got stabbed and stabbed them and shot people, got shot. You know, did a lot of barroom fights and stuff like that. But I also done stuff in cars. I worked on a movie called The Car, and I worked on a movie called The Driver, and I did some horror shows called like The Dark. That was the name, and I was a stunt coordinator on that. And in general, I did just whatever I could do whenever I could do it. And a lot of things I can't remember what they were, but it's just a feeling that you get when you want to do something and you don't want to just be your neighbor next door. You know, I wanted to be better than my, I always said but I'm really not any better than anybody else, but I do things that other people don't do. And that makes you feel like you're doing something. In other words, I'm just a little crazy.
Well, I don't know. Maybe so. I mean, I think falling off a horse or being in a wrecked car would classify you as a little bit crazy, but obviously you're here and it's worked, so that's great.
Well, the biggest part of that was not only the being somebody, but boy, the pay was sure good.
So your early days was mostly in television, in the golden age of television.
I believe I was in just, I don't know if I'd be in the golden age. To me, they were golden, but I think there's a lot of people in there before me that did tons of things a lot better. John Wayne, a million male actors were out there, and Ben-Hur and all them other big movies. That was, I think, those days before them movies, that was kind of the golden days. And I was in the good old days of motion pictures, I call it. That was before all those changes started coming in and just eating you up on everything you're trying to do. And there's so many people coming in and so many going out. It's hard to get a camaraderie with half of the people in the world.
Yeah, it makes a lot of sense. So it, one of the things you mentioned to me was in those early acting and stuntman roles, you played in a lot of the classic Westerns.
Yes, I did. I started off, here we go back. I did some waiver work before I ever did anything that I could say was movie work. Now, a waiver is just a person that they'd pick off of the street, and you'd walk down the street and they'd see you walking away. That's a waiver. And then after that, I started doing shows like I started off on Rawhide. That was my first big shows I was doing. Of course, I like I said before, I am a cowboy, and I did everything there was to do with horses, and even before that. So, all right, there's Rawhide, there's the Virginian, Laredo. Oh, good gosh. I never worked on Daniel Boone.
Okay, but definitely Gunsmoke.
Well, yeah, okay. Gunsmoke and Virginian and, yes, I worked on most all of those shows. And as a matter of fact, I don't think there was a Western that I didn't work on at least once or twice, which was good. Fortunately for me, Gunsmoke was the was my biggest pride, because I was, if you stretch it all out, I lasted about 8 years on Gunsmoke.
Wow.
Yeah, that was my biggest break, and my biggest break, I should say. And we got along real well, and I knew everybody on Gunsmoke, and they all knew me. And you know, we had lunch together, we played cards together at lunchtime. You know, Jack Elam, and I mean, good God, to try and think of all them people, it'd be. I'd be fumbling and mumbling here.
Is there any, like, one thing that stands out in those days that maybe you're most proud of, or maybe as a goof up that you had to do multiple times or something like that?
Yeah, I fouled up a few times, but I fouled up only on the side that I'm working on. I fouled up. I miss a pad when I come off of a horse. I get too close to a pole doing a drag, and things like that. That stuff that got to me pretty good. But for being proud, you know, it's hard to say, because I loved everything I did. Even if I did it wrong, then I hated me. I didn't hate what I did. But I said, you can always do tomorrow a little better than you did today, because you did today and you know what you did wrong.
Yeah, that of course, that makes perfect sense. When you were talking there, a question that I came to me was, have you ever been, and not necessarily in those Westerns, and you've had a much longer career, and, you know, definitely want to talk about that. But have you ever gotten hurt? I mean, really hurt, where, you know, it's maybe put you out of commission for a little bit?
I've never been hurt to where I've been out of commission. I've been hurt. I've gotten strawberries, and I've gotten bumps, and I've passed out and came to a few minutes later. It's just, you know, sometimes you fall and you fall harder than you think you're going to fall. But yes, I have had that happen. And darn, I kind of lost my train here. What else did you ask me?
No, I was just asking if you've ever been, you know, sort of more seriously hurt on set.
Oh, no, I never have. Good. Thank God for that. I mean, I've been stepped on and I've been kicked, but I've never had a bone broken that I know of.
Okay.
Well, and I'm proud of that. And before you asked me about a picture that I was really, really proud of, I'll tell you one that really, I think I can put it up. I've done all my shows and I really like the shows, but I did one big valley where I had a scene with Barbara Stanwyck. And now that was the only scene I've ever done with Mrs. Stanwyck. And I look back on that, and that puts a little feeling in me, knowing that what I worked with her. Now I've worked with on that picture Flubber. I can't think of his name either, but I've worked with a lot of people. And Jim Arness, I loved working with him. And Kenny Curtis, good God, just everybody I've enjoyed working with. But again, I was never I'm trying to say, I was never a guy that would go to work and when my job was done, I'd hang around. When I go to work, my job is done, I'm out of there. I go home. I got stuff to do at home. But I'm really proud of just about everything I have done. Even the spooky, gory, I did a picture called The Dark some time back, and I know all the actors in it, and I'll think of them tomorrow, but today I can't think of the names.
It's okay. When we were talking, it was kind of surprising the movies you were in. So, you know, maybe we could talk about just a little bit, just to name some of the movies you were in.
Well, I was in as we know, I was in The Great Race. That was a big movie. I was in one a long time ago called A Fever in the Blood. I think that was with Ethelm Zimbus Jr. Had just small daily things, all right? Gosh.
Well, you know, you were
I'm
in
proud
two,
of all of them.
You were in 2001, right?
Well, now you see, I worked for the picture of 2001 because I was a stuntman. And they were looking for somebody who could do wires work. So they rented a barn in Hollywood. And I went to that barn and they had it all set up with wires and pulleys and cables and stuff like that. And I did some shots where I was floating in air with the cable. Floating in air, and I did some upside down shots of working like this upside down, and I just did a lot of stuff like that, so that Gary Lockwood, that was the other guy, and I can't think of the other man's name.
Pierre Delay, I think, was in that.
Pierre Delay, yes. I can't think of it, but you turned me on to that. So, yes, and that was that. I think I did 2 days with that show. But that was, as far as I'm concerned, I worked on that. I wasn't in the film, unless maybe they had me running around in a monkey suit or something. No, I'm just kidding. The start of with all the monkies and getting mad and all that. Yeah, no, that wasn't me either.
Okay. I'm sure they, well, I was going to make a joke and say maybe they wouldn't need makeup, but that's okay.
Well, they wouldn't have if they wanted a human. What do we call the starts with an H? Anyway.
Yeah. Simian, probably, or something like that. But yeah.
Homo sapien versus
Homo sapien. That's right. Yeah. See, but if they wanted someone that could walk like an ape and climb and jump and do all that, well, I'd be available. I wanted to become
Bobby, you were a tree trimmer.
Yes. And I wanted to become an ape.
You were a tree trimmer, so you were you.
I did that, and it was all with ropes. They don't use ropes anymore. They got a crane to pick them up to the top of these big trees. They stand in a bucket and make their saws. Well, heck, some trees took me an hour and a half to get to the top of the damn things, climbing.
And we were talking earlier, and you were in the Navy for a number of years as well.
I was in the Navy since 1953 to 1957. And I was aboard the USS Yorktown on the Korean conflict and a little while after that. Yes, and I was aboard the USS Yorktown, like I said. And I'm proud of those days. I'm a little proud of those days. I was not the, what they call the, well, I'm going to say it. I was one of the best sailors on that ship, but I couldn't pass the test to get to make my grades. I'm not that kind of a sailor. I'm a working sailor.
That's all right. My dad was in the Army, and he was a working soldier.
He was a foot soldier, yeah.
A foot soldier.
I was in the Army for a year before I went in the Navy, but it wasn't the Army. It was Army National Guard. And I went to a place up in Northern California called Hunter Leggett. And I was attached to the tank squad, the cavalry, they called it. And I went up there for 2 weeks training what they do and slept on the ground and ate that food and stuff like that. When I got out, I said, you know, I think I like the Navy a little better. And I went and I went and I got in the Navy. I was in the Army for, well, discharge reads a year, but I was still in the Navy for four. So that's
an accomplishment. It's really an accomplishment.
Well, yeah, but at the time, see, I didn't look at it as accomplishments because I was young. I wasn't even 18 when I was in the Army. And I took off from home when I was young, very young. And that's when I started getting in heavy with the horses. And since then, I've been around horses all my life. Still got them.
Living on a ranch.
Yeah, I have a little spread here of several acres, and good God, comes spring, the grass is growing taller than heck, and it all has to be cut. And yeah, trees have to be trimmed, everything has got to be done, fences have to be fixed.
When the trees have to be trimmed, do you get somebody with a crane, or do you climb those trees?
No, I don't get anybody with a crane, but I still climb some of them. I can still put the hooks on and go, but I'm not going to go up no 150 feet anymore, 200 feet in a tree. Uh-oh, not anymore. My legs won't get me up that high.
And I can't blame you. And I can't blame you.
Yeah. But that's it.
Go ahead.
Yeah.
I wanted to talk a little bit about your friend that's behind you.
Yes. That's he's calm now, but he's usually gorny.
Gorny, okay.
Gorny, yeah. Yeah.
So maybe we could talk a little bit about Star Trek. You're a character you played a character.
Yes.
That's become very iconic in the Gorn.
Thank you. Yes, and I realize that. I did my first convention in the year 2000, and I've done a lot of conventions since then all over. I've been in England, been in Germany, and just with him. And he hangs on with me all the time. Now, tell you the story of how I got the job. Joseph Peveney was the director, and I had worked with him before on other shows. And he come up to me one day and he says, "Bobby, I got a job for you." I says, "Great." I says, when do we start?" He's out in a couple of weeks or something. I says, "Well, good. What's it going to be?" He says, "Oh, just a normal everyday thing." And he says, "You'll like the show. You'll like it." So, all right. Then a week later went by. He says, "Well, they want to see a wardrobe and they want to talk to you about, getting into the wardrobe and stuff." So I says, "Yeah, I'll go down." So I went down to the wardrobe department at Desilu, which is Paramount Studios. And I told them that I'm Bobby Clark and so forth, and I come for a fitting. And they says, "Yeah, your wardrobe's all set up in the dressing room." So I go to the dressing room. I'm standing there, and I said, "There's no wardrobe here. What are you talking about?" They said, "Your wardrobe, it's on the rack." I says, "There's nothing on the rack. There's some stuff hanging over the top bar." And they says, "Well, that's your wardrobe." I says, "It can't be." So we went there and he showed me the wardrobe. And I says, "Well, what is this?" He says, "Well, you're the Gorn." And I says, "I'm the Gorn. What is a Gorn?" And he pulls up the costume and, oh, good God, I found out what was such a good job. So, but, excuse me, I got into it and it fit good, and et cetera. So I got the job and went to where the location was, and I got into the costume. They told me, they said, "Bobby," says, "it would be better and advisable if you wouldn't drink too much coffee before you get to work tomorrow. And don't eat too heavy or anything like that." And I says, "Oh, well, sure, no problem." Well, I followed the tracks a little bit. I had a couple of cups of coffee that morning and stuff like this. And then I got to wondering, where do I go to the bathroom? But that was all one piece. I slipped my both legs in it and I pulls it up. It's a diver's wetsuit was the base of it.
Really?
And a wardrobe man named Hua Chang was the designer of this wardrobe. So he had the bottom part as a wetsuit. The top part was of a wetsuit. It came down and it snapped and it zipped up. And it could be very hot when the days got that way. But I sat there and I got to thinking. I said, "Well, what do I do about going to the bathroom?" I said, "Well, you got two choices. You got to walk up them stairs and go in the honey wagon, or you can just do it in the costume." Because it was all rubber anyway, but I never did that. But it was hard going to the restroom, I'll tell you, because all that rubber has to come off and peel down, and stuff like that. But that was the second big thing that I had to do. And then I found out that I could not sit in a chair on the set because I couldn't sit with the costume on, with all the extra rubber put on it. So my perch, excuse me, was a ladder. So they put a ladder up against a rock, and I had to climb a few steps up in the ladder, and that's where I stood until the director said, "Bobby, we're going to shoot the shot." Well, that was my third. And then he called me, and we're getting ready to do the shot and stuff, and I had to, you know, I had to be the Gorn, which, by the way, the Gorn that you heard on TV and stuff, that was not me. That was done by another actor, I found out later. And I also had a lot of problems walking with that costume on because the feet were long feet, and I could see, but I couldn't see like I can see right now. But I looked through it and I could see where I was going and stuff like that, which was no problem. But getting where I was going was the problem, because we filmed it at a place called Vasquez Rocks in Agua Dulce, California. And I'm walking around there at this time, and there's a lot of sagebrush and a lot of scrub oaks and all this kind of stuff out there that you got to be walking through. Well, a foot would get caught in one, and I'd take it, and then I couldn't move. And that was a cut. We had to do it over again. I had to figure out where I'm going to put my feet. And then it would happen again. It happened, you know, off and on, but we got it all done. And, well, the fight was no problem. It was, as you say, the people on the press said that was the lousiest fight they've ever seen on television. Yeah, that was the worst fight on television. That Gorn couldn't move good. But I enjoyed it. It was hot in that costume. And between shots, they would take the head off me, and I could unzip the thing after I took the, what did they call that? It was like a vest or something. I took that off, and then I could open it up, breathe while they're setting up another shot to do. So that was how the Gorn got to moving around.
So being a Star Trek fan and having, you know, grown up, I really have grown up watching the original series, the Gorn, and it sounds like it might have been a product of the costume, but the Gorn moves slow, it swings, or it waves its arms very slowly. Was that because of the costume, or did they tell you to be that kind of a character?
No, I could move fast because if I was out in the open, I could move fast. But he wanted it to be a cumbersome journey. All the walking was cumbersome because he's a reptilian and he don't move fast, or he can't do quick stuff. So like when he swung to hit Kirk, it was a big wide sweeping thing, and then Kirk would come in on him and do his thing, and he'd grab a hold of him, and it was quite a show. A lot of stuff goes through your head. Well, why can't I do this? But the director knows what he wanted. We gave it to him, and he was very happy with it. And I guess a million people out there are happy also, and I'm glad.
I think maybe more than a million people out there are happy about it.
Yes, yes.
It's and really an iconic character that has been used since. In fact, I think in an episode of Star Trek Enterprise, they brought back the Gorn, although he was CGI.
Well, but that Gorn, that is the one that I mentioned, that they invited me to come to the set and sit while they did that scene. And that was very interesting to see. However, when he brought out the model of the Gorn, it didn't look like to me it was a Gorn, because it was, of course, it was on wire, and he had it all decked out to look like what it was. But did a heck of a job with that too.
Yeah.
You didn't see much of it, I don't believe. You just seen a little shadow or hand or something like that, which I didn't see when I was sitting there.
So since we're kind of on the subject of the Gorn, there's someone that I know who really wanted to meet you. And she plays Baby Gorn.
Yes. You speak of this. I'm sorry to interrupt. I'll tell you another thing that the Gorn did. I was in London, and I was doing a show there, a convention, and I was the Gorn. And apparently in London there, they had a whole lot of people who were Gorn fans. Now, this is the first time I've ever seen something like that, a whole group of people that were Gorn fans. And when I walk in the room, they'd start saying, "Gorn, Gorn, Gorn." I mean, that's how heavy it was. And it just took me back on seeing something like that. And then it was, as a matter of fact, I was there on my birthday. And while I was there, getting ready to have the birthday party or present or whatever it was called, down the stairs came a lady who had made a Gorn costume, her own self. She made it, and boy, and it was funny, because the minute I saw her, all I could do was, oh, what is this? Where did this come from? And I says, you know, I says, I knew there was another Gorn in this world. I could smell her. And that was really something. The first Gorn I ever saw was in London.
Well,
that was pretty. This little girl, you're gonna show me.
This might be your daughter. Uh-huh. It might be your daughter.
All right.
Sarai, are you there?
Yes, I am.
And there she is. That's Sarai Duane.
Hi, Sarai. How are you?
Hi, how are you?
I'm fine,
thank you.
You can see that she's got her Gorn. Gorn mask.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, it's just Gorn. Just Baby Gorn.
And nice, I have.
He's just Gorn.
Yeah.
And I have some pictures of Sarai in her outfit.
That's cute. Yeah. That costume that she's got on, that's on top of the rubber set. That's called a tunic. That's what that's called. Mm-hmm. A tunic.
They
call that a tuna, and that's what you're wearing there. And I see also you got the starship on your shirt.
Yeah,
that's a pretty shirt.
Thank you. Me and my dad actually made this.
Do you see my Gorn up here next to me?
I see. I actually had a question about the mask. Through my mask, I can see through the nostrils and the mouth, but where could you see through your mask?
Well, where the mouth was is where my chin rested.
Yeah.
Because I had to open and close the mouth, so I couldn't see through that. And the nose was too wide to see. Now, there's a couple little slits underneath the eye, underneath both eyes. See those little... Well, we call them bags nowadays when you get older, but they got them. But I could also see through the sequences a little bit, so I could see through all that. But it seems like you got a pretty good view of everything if you can see through the mouth. But you got to open it a little bit to see better, don't you?
Well, actually, some of it, he's going through losing his teeth because he has. Well, never mind. He's lost a lot of teeth, so, but the mouth is actually quite big. So I can't see through the eyes because they're not made out of sequins. They're actually made out of foam balls and pins and beads. So,
That's all right.
You know, I can see through his mouth because that's where my head, that's where my eye level is.
So, yes. Well, mine fit pretty well, although it was big for me and I had to move around in it, but it worked all right. Yeah. So you like the Gorn, huh? Well, I appreciate that. It's a nice, lovely little girl like you likes a creature as a Gorn.
Well, thank you, Sarai. I'm glad you made it. I'm glad you had a chance to talk to Bobby.
Well, thank you for having me.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And I thank you for meeting me and thank you for letting me talk with you.
Awesome. Actually, I recalled that we were both on Star Trek Continues.
Star Trek. Yes, but I didn't do much on that. I did a thing that we in the picture business call a cameo, where it was because I was the Gorn, and this was quite back, and it was called. It was the Fairest of Them All.
I think it was.
No, it was called Unbelievable.
Oh, that's the new guest.
Yeah, it was called Unbelievable, and I was daddy to another Lady Gorn on that show, and I had a cameo on it. So that's something you can go see. It's kind of funny. I think it's funny anyway. Captain Kirk was a puppet, and he was running everything.
Is there a lot of who was can't think of the person, I'm sorry, I'm thinking of an actor, but he's more of I don't know what he is, maybe I'm you know what,
well, I know exactly what you're going through right now because I've been going through it time and time again. It's called a memory lapse.
It's called a senior moment.
Did you
think
of it yet?
I think he froze up moment. On all us. Right.
It's easy to get those. Did you think of it yet?
I think he's froze up.
Yeah.
He's froze up.
Well, we got a couple of questions here I want to throw at you while we're waiting for him to reconnect.
And sweetheart, wait, hold on half a second. Sweetheart, it's good to have been with you and just keep going with the Gorn. One day you'll be a big Gorn.
I do want to meet you in person one day, maybe after all this stuff is
And where are you? Where do you live?
I live in South Carolina.
Well, they do have a show down there, a convention, but they haven't called or asked me to come to it yet. But someday I probably might make that.
Yeah, someday.
Excuse me. Anyways, and I'll be looking forward. And I will be looking forward. And if the permitting, I will arrange to have a picture sent to you.
Okay, thank you. It's nice meeting you.
Signed and personalized. You're welcome.
Thanks, Sarai. Live long and prosper, Sarai.
I live long and prosper. Did you figure out what you were thinking of?
No, I lost my connection online and with it went my brain, Bobby, brain.
Well, mine's probably where yours is anyway.
It could be. So, just staying with Star Trek a little bit. So you were in a couple of other episodes as well.
Yes, I was in one called Return of the Archons. And I was in one called Mirror, Mirror. That was a very, very quick one. I see you have the picture of me right there on your on your wall. I'm getting phasered. Well, we had a little skirmish in the hotel, in the elevator room. and I got thrown down to the floor, and then I got zapped there. And the other one was called the Apple. Now, I was in the Apple as a worshiper of a creature called
Val.
Val, yeah. Oh, very good. Thank you. Anyway, I had nice, long, fuzzy hair. I forgot. I think the color was purple or something. And I was one of the people that were going to kill Captain Kirk. And I attacked him. And naturally, he whooped me and threw me over his shoulder. And I went down, and then he went down, and then I went to go back at him. But we didn't kill him. And that was those two. Now, the other one was one called Return of the Archons. And they were a group of people who says live long and prosper and peace and tranquility. And they had hoods on and they had sticks and stuff like that. But at a certain time of the year, I guess it was, everybody was cut loose of the machine that ran them. And they called it a festival. So my shot in that was, which I had a part in it as well, I run to the camera and I'm hollering, festival, festival. And then I turn around and I run away again. So that was Return of the Archons. And then the other one, naturally, is the arena.
Interesting. When you go to conventions, Star Trek conventions, do you talk mostly about arena, or do you talk about these other roles as well?
Well, you know, I love to go to the conventions because I love to meet the people. Now, we talk about everything, but the main thing that they're there for is because of the Gorn. That they come up to me and say, well, you're the Gorn, and so forth, and we talk, and then I ask them, you know, well, where are you from and so forth. I find out that a lot of people that I talk to are from the same state that I had been in, and I know a little bit about the states, and we just get along very well together, and we joke and they joke and tell me things, and then, you know, I tell them things, and it's just kind of a little get together, and then there's always somebody comes up behind them and I go through it all again.
Cool. I'm going to ask Dan or Larry. I've been seeing a lot of chatter. Are there any questions that anyone's asking?
Well, there's a lot of questions, and the one I've always wanted to ask is, you've worked with Bill Shatner. I've had the chance to interview him as an older guy, but what was it like in period working with Bill Shatner, working with Leonard Nimoy, working with the original cast?
Well, you see, I didn't work with Shatner except on Return on the Arena. That I worked with Shatner then. I worked on other shows with him, and he's just Bill Shatner. He's very, very right to the point. I get along fairly well with him. I didn't for a while, but things kind of got better, and they're okay now. I met him in Pennsylvania here. Good God, it was last year, but of course I haven't done any conventions this year, but I met him in Pennsylvania last year, and we got along great in the room, and I did a Q&A and he did his thing, but we don't do a lot of work. Now, I worked with him on TJ Hooker. I did a couple of those, and he was the cop, and I was the guy that got hurt or did something nasty. I didn't have any parts in it. It's just something that had to be done. Excuse me. And I didn't do too many shows with Bill, but he did a couple of shows in the in the convention that I was in. He was directing something, and I never know what he was directing. I'd see him, I'd say hi, Bill, and that's about it. So it was never close. And God darn it, Spock.
Nimoy.
Leonard Nimoy was really a super guy. I mean, he read a lot and stuff like this. And I never bothered with him too much either, but he was always polite and always nice. And he'd say, hi, Bob. And I'd say, hi, Leonard, whatever. We were just cordial. So that's, I never got into being a friend with the actors until like at lunchtime, but this was always with the cowboy stuff. And it would be lunchtime, and we'd go across the street to a little bar that had a restaurant and stuff, and we'd talk, and they'd play cards. I didn't play cards and stuff, but it was all just very cordial talk, the star Gunsmoke.
James Arness.
James Arness. Yes. Now we would talk a little bit, but never much. I'd just say hi, or tell him this, and if I doubled him, I'd talk to him a little bit there, and et cetera. But there's very few people that I worked with that I would be like buddies, you know what I'm saying? And on a show or whatever, I'd see them at the rodeos, and then we'd talk a little bit and kick around, and then we'd go our different ways again.
I hear there's a great story about how you got into the conventions. A family member came up and showed you a Gorn. And you said, what is that? I know that's all I had handy. Sorry. But the bottom line is apparently you didn't realize.
Go get one of those rubber Gorns. It's on the shelf up there by the TV. Go get one of them, will you please? That's a rubber Gorn, a little one. He's standing on a thing. Yeah, I'll show you what he came up. That was my son. Now that is that he worked in the business of redoing the Civil War stuff, reenactors, and he got his own group and stuff. So he was in the business for a little while. He lives in Colorado now, and he raises bucking bulls for the rodeos. Now, if you will, I'll show you the one he showed me. Can you see this one?
Yep, raise it up a bit. Got to keep coming up. Probably about.
Oh, there it is.
Oh my.
There.
That is the one my son brought me. Now, he always harped at me, why don't you do a convention? I says, why? I don't want to do a convention. And this was probably it was before 2000. I think it was the year before 2000. That was 1999. And finally, I said to him, I says, all right. I says, I'll agree to do a convention with you. And he says good. And he arranged everything for my first convention, which was for Creation Entertainment. At that time, they were doing a show in Pasadena, and it was called the Grand Slam. That was the first one I ever did. So I figured, all right, I'll appease him. I went out and I had 50 photographs, 8x10s made of the Gorn throwing a rock, black and white. Excuse me again. And then there's another one I had made, was just the Gorn standing there in front of the tree. I think you've got one right behind you there. And I went to there and he set it up, and I went to Pasadena and I had these 100 photographs, and I go in the room and there's a table there. It said Bobby Clark, and I put my pictures down and I'm looking around, and good God, everybody's got pictures all over the place. Well, I just hid these. I'm appeasing my son. Well, I would say less than an hour, I was out of pictures. That was it. I was out of pictures. Didn't have any more. It was Saturday. So that shot me down there. And that was quite a surprise. And I just went to the next convention. And then I went to another convention and I got more pictures. I had some taken off of the arena movie that was there. The DVD, is that what it's called? Mm-hmm. Yeah, I had some pictures taken off of the DVD, and it was, you know, I was surprised as hell. I mean, really, really took me aback, and I said, well, I'll be ready for the next one. And in time, it turned out that because of the part I played, there's only 10 pictures that I have that are fairly good sellers or signature takers. Pretty good photo. And I've been going with that and going with that and going with that every year. And it ceases to amaze me that the people are still so interested in the Gorn.
You know, one of the viewers, I'm going to turn this back to Dan in a second, but one of our followers, Bob Kinney, says, did you ever think that the Gorn would become an iconic villain for Star Trek?
Well, I don't know what that was that you said, but I never thought the Gorn would do anything. I never believed in the Gorn until after the second and third, and from then on, that it's just been Gorn, 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 Gorn. And how do I say this? My claim to fame is this lizard behind me. You know,
you're an action figure. You are an action figure now.
Yeah, I sure am. And I'm surprised in it. That just it really floors me to know that so many people can do that. I was always a quiet type of show off, or whatever you wanted to call it, but I never did much like, you know, I'm the Gorn. I still say, yeah, I was the Gorn. and it's still, like I say, that's my claim to fame. And I've done westerns all my life, been on horseback all my life, and did all this stuff here. And just do people come up and say, hey, I saw you ride this bull. You did a good job. I never see that. Of course, I never did a good job on it. I usually bucked off or whatever. But this here, people are just so glad to see him. And I'm still going.
That's good.
Like you right here. You have all these photos behind you. And here I am, and I'm talking to you. And I know there's going to be a million people seeing your show. And I hope they like me too, but if they do, fine. If they don't, I'm here.
There is nothing not to like about you, Bobby. There is nothing not to like. I can tell you that.
I try to be, go ahead.
No, you go.
I try to be cordial, and I am a polite person. My wife may argue with me, but that's only standard. My wife and I, we've been married for 54 years, 56 years. Now, see, I'm going to get dialogue now.
Now, yeah, you're going to get it.
I'm going to get flack. I'm going to get flack.
That's okay. That's also an accomplishment. No kidding. That's also an accomplishment.
Yeah, she likes me still.
Must be
well,
the
Bobby, board. I wouldn't sell yourself short. I'm looking at your IMDb page right here, and there's 27 credits for stunts alone. There's 13 acting credits. I mean, that's pretty serious stuff there.
Well, you know, I never got along too well with IMDb. And I know there's a whole lot more stuff that should be there, but I don't care about what is on IMDb. If people want to look me up, they can look me up. But I know there's more than that on there, because, like I say, you know, a stuntman doesn't really get credits for what for, like, when they show the credits on the end of the show. They never used to do that. So I was just whatever I was, and IMDb's got some of it, and they didn't get some of the other stuff. So I just let it go. I don't pay that much attention to it.
Well, it's still a sample of what you've done, and you've obviously been telling us more.
Yes. No, that's I was just telling you why I didn't really this was years ago when I looked it up. I wanted to see what I did, and they had a few things on there that I did do, and then they had some things that I didn't do, and I just said, well, what about this? And then they said, oh, well, we'll do this and we'll do that. And then I just figured, well, I'll, you know, let it be. If people ask me, I'll tell them. See, there was one and that I think it was years ago. It's called Casey Jones. Is that on there still?
I'm off of it now, I'm sorry to say.
Oh, no, that's all right. That's all right. Forget it anyway. I did not do Casey Jones. I was not the Bobby Clark that did Casey Jones. So now I have to explain to people when they come and I say, no, that was not the, that wasn't me. I wasn't on that. And I just don't pay any attention to what goes on in the press or anything like that.
Well, we have a question here from Anthony Armstrong, and I'll add another name to it. But his question is, did you work with any of the actors in Westerns before they did Star Trek, like DeForest Kelly, Ricardo Montalban? I'll even think of an actor who I worked with who played Apollo, and he worked on a set with me, Michael Forrest. Did you know any of those guys in Westerns in their multitude of TV appearances?
I'll tell you, DeForest Kelly, I saw him once. But again, see, I was a rodeo boy, and I was on the racetracks, and I was home. I didn't go out to dinners, and I didn't go to places like that before I got into the studios. And there's several actors that I've spoken to, and I still speak to them. And I'd have to look in my darn book to find their names, but it's not somebody that I palled around with or anything like that. I may have seen them, but to me, they were just, they didn't impress me, so to speak. I'm sorry to say. Charlton Heston, now, yeah, I met him because I was working for a fellow that did Ben-Hur, and I met Chuck, and we'd talk, and I'd say hi, he'd say hi, how you doing? And that's as far as it went. I mean, it was not like, what are you doing now, or anything like that. And let's see, who else? Well, Gene Autry. You know, just passing friends is all they were. I knew who they were, but it didn't make a big impression on me that they were who they were on the screen.
Yeah, but see, still, you had the chance to work with them. No, you had the chance to work with them. I mean, and just be able to say, yeah, I used to say hi to Chuck, and you're meeting Charlton Heston. That's for a fan of films like I am, that's really cool. And the nice thing now is that there's so many of these TV shows and films on retro TV channels that I wouldn't be surprised people who are watching you right now are this weekend going to be hunting you down, trying to find the moves, the movies, the TV shows you were in and watch and say, I just saw him.
Some people say that when they come to the convention, they say, oh, I just saw you the other night on TV. You know, I say, well, God bless you for coming by and saying hi. I'm not thinking that they're after a photograph. I just thought it was nice of them to come by and say hi because they saw me. Now I got a frog or something in my throat. But anyway, and there's a lot of, when you say that, there are a lot of people that I have seen in a couple of restaurants that I would go. There's a restaurant in North Hollywood that I used to go to, a Sittin's, I think it was. And there was a lot of people come in there, and I'd see some of the people that I had worked with, but I don't really, when I worked with them, I worked with them because it was professional. It was not, let's go have a beer or something like that. And maybe I'm just not in that kind of a group of with people.
You know, there's been more. There's been more than one comment here that says, there's been more than one comment here that says, you sound just like a regular guy.
Well,
I guess you're a regular guy.
I am, because I'm just Bobby Clark, you know. It's I still like to be noticed as Bobby Clark, but not as the Gorn or any of the creatures or whatever. Like Kenny Curtis, for instance, I knew Kenny. He lived up in Fresno, and people like Merle Haggard and that's my group of people, but they're more to me than Rock Hudson or somebody like that. Frederick, I worked with Fred McMurray on a thing called Flubber years and years ago. And I seen him once since then. And I said, hi, Fred. And he just looked at me. Of course, I remember them and I know who they are. But half of them, unless I've doubled them and tried to figure out, you know, their moves a little bit, they don't know who I am. I've doubled, Kenny Curtis, for instance, Festus. I've doubled him several times. And it's just, I see him on the set and he'll say hi and I'll say hi. And that's about it. But I'll see him on the road or at a rodeo or something and we'll talk and we'll shoot the shit a little bit. But that's as far as that goes. Sweet. I'd rather be, beg your pardon?
I was going to say, we have a young man who's in the Zoom room with us, who's asked several interesting questions on Facebook, but I thought maybe I'd give him a chance to come in and talk to you directly and ask you a couple of questions. So Christopher Collins, Christopher, can you Zoom in?
Sure, I'm right here. How you doing? I've actually seen you before at a Star Trek convention.
How you doing, Christopher?
You're great. I'm doing good.
I was curious,
what genre did you prefer working in? Did you have a specific genre you liked more than others? In film or whatever?
Stuntman, acting, which you prefer?
What type of show?
What was the?
What was your favorite genre that you liked acting or doing stunt work in?
You know, I had a lot of fun on every show I ever did, because I'm with my comrades, so to speak, and the people I know, and we'll get together. I'll help them do something. They'll help me do something. But as far as really feeling great about it, you know, it's always the biggest time I feel great about anything is when I get up, dust myself off, and say, let's do something else. that I feel great for. Chris, I don't know exactly what you meant to say. So I don't really hear too well anyway with my ears. And you go ahead.
Oh, no problem. My other question, Chris, was, did you ever get?
Go ahead, Chris. Nope, you're on mute.
My other question was, did you ever get to interact with Gene Roddenberry?
You got cut off of me again, Chris.
I guess his question is, did you ever get a chance to work with Gene Roddenberry when you were on Star Trek?
Well, I never worked with Gene Roddenberry. He came to the set, and I've seen him on the set. And I think that his son Rod and I are pretty good friends. However, I think I maybe spoken to him 4 times in a year, but he's always glad to hear from me, and I'm always glad to hear from him. So as far as the Roddenberries go, yeah, I like Gene. His name is Gene, but they called him Rod. That's Roddenberry's son. And he's quite a guy. He has his own little, he has a big booth that he does. He's very interested in things that he does. And he's a great guy. His dad was great. His dad was very business and stuff. And his mother also.
Great. Thank you, Chris. I appreciate it.
I hope I answered that question for you. I appreciate you asking, Chris. And
so, Bobby, you also
what did you say, Chris?
I think he gave you a thumbs up.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think he gave you a thumbs up.
You cut out on me again.
So, Bobby, you also have a book that you've published, right?
Yes, I do. I do. It's just a little book that my wife and I wrote about my life a little bit. And it started when I was in the Navy, and there's some stuff about my days in the Navy and stuff I did, and just some pictures of me in general, if people are interested. And it's an interesting book. A lot of people say they like it. Me, I just I have it on my table when I do a convention and so forth, and I don't know how people can do a picture of the book. If you want to see it, I'll just hold it up here, I will.
Okay.
I don't know how in the heck I could get one to you. Can you see it?
Just bring it up a little bit. There we go. Gorn to Trek. That's great.
And it's all about, you know, kind of my life and stuff, and you know, just a little bit about me.
So
and that's and then it goes up into the Gorn and stuff, and then
there's been a couple of questions. Anthony Armstrong said, and I'm asking you this question because I
couldn't understand you on that.
Okay. I'm going to ask you this question that Anthony Armstrong has online. But I know you gave me a slightly different answer than probably what he's looking for. So it says, he said, doing Westerns would have to rate up there. I mean, who wouldn't want to play a cowboy growing up? But I know you said, you know, there was a point in your life where you wanted to do away with the cowboy.
Well, yeah, that's when I got discharged from the Navy. I started thinking about it a little bit before I got discharged, saying, you know, I'm not going to get into that horse stuff anymore, because, you know, I never really made a killing on anything. I just worked 40 hours or 80 hours or whatever I worked. I worked until I was done, and when I was done, I was done. And it never seemed to fulfill me until I started working in the motion picture business, because I had a lot of camaraderie with the extras, and the extras were cowboys, and I met a lot of those guys on the in the arena, not the arena with the Gorn, but the arena with the horses and the bulls and roping, and, you know, with all the cowboys. And they're the ones that told me, you know, well, you know, if you want a job, just become an extra. You're a cowboy, you can do it. And I found out that I could do it. So, and I did it.
I have a question. Are you the cowboy in the picture behind you?
Yes, I am, I think. Yeah. Yes, I am. That's me.
You're a good-looking cowboy.
God, I hope not. I would be a star. No, thank you very much. I appreciate that.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
I appreciate that. I don't have a lot of pictures of me anywhere. But you know what I do have? I have got a ton of action figures of the Gorn. I collect them. I don't know why. I just collect them. I even got a R2-D2, a small R2-D2. My rug is too big for him to run on, but I got him. Those are little things that impressed me.
And that's great. It kind of surprises me that you would have a collection of Gorns, but maybe I shouldn't be surprised by anything you do.
Yeah. You look like you've weathered pretty well over the years. My dad had a good friend by the name of John Eckert, and he was a stunt double for Gary Cooper. And by the time I met him,
John Eckert.
And he was a stunt double for Gary Cooper. And by the time I met him, he was pretty beat up. And a lot of my memories of him is him sitting around drinking to ease the pain.
Are you sure it wasn't John?
Johnny Eckert.
Are you sure? You sure it's not Epper? E-P-P-E-R?
No.
S-O-N? Epperson?
No, it's Eckert. When my dad when my dad first met him, he was managing Bing Crosby's ranch in northeast Nevada.
Not necessarily the same guy there.
Well, I'll be darned. My wife just brought me out two Gorns. I'm gonna show them to you if you want to see them. This is something to look at. Now tell me what you think of these two.
Bring them back just a little bit. A little too close to the screen. Are those? I don't recognize those. Are those handmade?
Yes, they are. A fan made those for me and brought them to my table when I was there. And they're both Mr. and Mrs. Gorn.
Gotta love it. Gotta
is
love
that
it.
Something or is that something?
That's something. That's something. It's just amazing.
Yeah, it's really.
It's amazing the love that Star Trek fans have for the people who have been in Star Trek and for some of the characters, you know?
It is really something. Yeah, it's really something. You know, I've known these people for several years now, and I don't even recall talking to hardly any of them, the actors or actresses that I've worked with. I just, you know, of course, again, like I said, I'm not an actor, I'm a stuntman, so. I'm concerned with the person that I'm doubling and the thing I have to do. But the other people, when they're working, when they're on dialogue, they're usually on the stage or they're somewhere else and I'm over here and they're over there. So I don't really get in close with them because they're working and I'm working.
Exactly. And it certainly makes sense. You know, we all think, it's glamorous to work in Hollywood or, you know, on television, but it's really a job, right? It's a job.
It is a job. It's a job that you do the best you can, and you hope that you get called back to do another one.
I get it. So for the folks that are online, Larry Fleming had posted a couple of links. So there's two different links where you can find Bobby's book, one of those being Amazon. So you may be able to get a copy of Bobby's book on Amazon. And we have a link that, again, if you would like to get a personalized autographed picture of Bobby, there's a link there to our website, and you can certainly do that. But we've had a lot of people through here today just talking about what a good guy you are and very impressed with your background. Is there anything we haven't talked about, Bobby, that you would like to mention?
Well, yeah, there is. When it gets dark here, there's a million rabbits on my front lawn. How in the heck do I get rid of them?
I think you have to watch Warner Brothers cartoons for that.
Yeah, well, that wacky rabbit, the Porky Pig, he don't know how to shoot them anymore.
That's true. Nah, well, you can't shoot
just
him
about.
I
shoot them.
Well,
maybe I shouldn't say that. No, I don't shoot them. No, I got a dog that chases them away when he's awake.
That's politically correct.
Yeah, but, when that dog's awake, he'll chase a rabbit.
Exactly. But, I really want to thank you for being with us. This was I had a ball. I really had a ball. It was great meeting you. Great seeing a lot of the comments for people who really they love you. It's not just the Gorn. They really love you, and I think that says a lot about you as a person.
Well, I can appreciate that, and. I don't know how to show appreciation for that other than just be like I am and do like I do. But there's one thing though, that little girl that was on, if somehow or other you can send something to me or that I can get a picture to her, I will give her a signed autograph of me if I can know where to send it and stuff. So
I'll make
sure you find that out for me. I'd be glad to put one in.
I'll make sure that that happens. And Sarai is still online and she's clapping for you.
Oh, God bless her. S-A-R, how's that spelled?
S-A-R-A-I.
A Sarai. All righty.
All right. So.
All righty. I got it. And have her, you know, send me her address tomorrow or the next day or whenever you get the chance to do it. Send it, and I will definitely send her a little picture of the Gorn.
And Sarai says she's gonna. Yep, Sarai said she's gonna send you one of her pictures signed as well.
Yeah, I'd appreciate that too. That's very nice. I get pictures frequently from some of the actors and some of the fans and stuff like that, and also I do these shows at the at the conventions. They're called what do they call it when I take a picture with the people? Photo ops. See how I'm getting to be forgetting? I'm forgetting a simple word like photo op. And I know what it means, and I know what it is, and I know how to say it, but not right now. And you're cutting out on my TV a little bit here.
Am I?
Whatever it is I'm looking at.
Okay. No, I see you just fine, so I'm sorry for that.
Oh, don't choke yourself.
I won't.
You're sorry for that.
Yeah,
exactly. You're sorry you see me just fine. No. Yeah, the satellites do this. Oh, yeah. So anyway, does that about wind this thing up? Or are you going to be doing all right with this on the air?
Absolutely. We've been live on Facebook. And probably by the weekend, we'll also be up on YouTube. So lots of people are going to see this.
Go what on YouTube? I don't get YouTube, I don't think.
You might.
Oh, we get YouTube? My wife says, what? My wife says we get YouTube. I don't know what we get. Hell, I watch the news and I watch a couple of shows and I'll go to bed.
I get it. Trust me, I get it. But yes, this was a lot of fun. Maybe we can do this again, you know, somewhere down the road, but I'd love to do it. And maybe when all of this other nonsense with COVID and all of that passes, maybe I could even take a trip out to California. I'd love to meet you in person.
Where are you?
I am about as far away from you as I could be. I'm in South Florida.
Oh, that's right. You're in South Florida. Yeah. Maine is as far as you can get from me.
Well, okay. That's true.
No, South Florida. What part of Florida?
Boca Raton.
What part of Florida are you in?
It's Boca Raton.
Where? Boca Raton. It sounds
about
Boca Raton, but is that what?
It's about
is that just about by. Is that by the Keys anywhere?
No, actually, we're about 3 hours north of the Keys.
Uh-huh. You're back up on the arm that hangs down. I did some commercials for Chrysler around the Keys.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Boats for Chrysler Marine.
Okay.
Yeah, that was quite interesting. That was interesting. So, I've done stuff for Chrysler and Dodge, and that's just commercials though. And I did one time for Goodrich tires.
Yeah.
Anyhow, we'll talk about that another time.
Okay. That's a deal. Again, I appreciate you being with us, Bobby. Lots of hearts, lots of smiles, lots of thumbs up on the website. So I really do appreciate it. Thank you. Mm-hmm.